So thank you, Lucy and Catherine, for the nice introductions, and thank you to Richard Bellamy for inviting me. It's a great honor for me to have been invited to give this Max Weber lecture in front of this audience that I'm sure will have many challenging and stimulating questions. In my lecture today, so I want to address this more general issue of the continuing racial construction of the nation in post-World War II Europe. This is, of course, not a new subject in European historiography, but I will look at it through the story of the mixed-race children born in Italy during and immediately after the Second World War. I refer to them as brown babies. Using the expression commonly employed at the time by African Americans, to avoid the racial term mostly used by the Italians at the time, meaning mulattini, little mulattoes. Now, until very recently, Italian historians have mostly ignored their presence. Yet their stories offer plenty of insights on the attitudes towards race, not only of post-war, post-fascist Italian society, but also of a major institutional actor, which historians of racism tend to neglect, namely the Catholic Church. Since Max Weber was particularly attentive to the subject of organized religion, as we'll know, and its impact on society, it may be appropriate to dwell on the Catholic Church for this lecture series dedicated to his memory and his work. However, I have to make a disclaimer, I'm not a historian of religion, and this lecture will not engage with the history of religion as much as with Catholicism, or better, some particularly important Catholics, Catholic actors, some clergymen, and others who were very close to them and to the Pope at the time. So I'm not talking about the church as a whole, as a monolith, but some prominent figures who shaped what the church was at the time. The subject of the brown babies born in World War II Europe lends itself naturally to a comparative perspective, since several European countries faced what was almost unanimously seen at the time as a problem, and since they were all looking for solutions of one kind or another. There is also a transnational dimension, so what is interesting also about this story is the transnational dimension, because the Catholic Church as an institution is a transnational, global institution. So, par excellence. So, children of mixed parentage, European and African Americans, or non-white European, white and non-white, were born in all European countries occupied or otherwise visited by the Allies' armies during and after the war. In the UK, until the end of the war, from 1942 until 1945, about 22,000 children were born from the relationships among British women and Allied soldiers. And even though a stigma attached to all children born out of wedlock, as most war children, this is the expression used at the time, were, those with a darker skin faced an even more difficult existence, since they were more often abandoned in children's homes, because their mother tried to avoid the stigma that attached to their illegitimate birth, which their skin color made impossible to ignore. Indeed, in all European cases, the dark skin of the children determined also a greater stigmatization of their mostly unwed mothers, who could not at all hide what was, in most cases, the fruit of an unwanted pregnancy. In Great Britain, the women who had relations with GIs were referred to as good time girls and shunned by respectable public opinion. Brown babies were even defined as the offspring of the scum of the British Isles. In US-occupied Germany from 45 to 1950, about 3,000 black or biracial occupation children, to use the expression of Heidi Fehrenbach, who studied this case, were born out of a total of about 94,000 occupation children. and the number grew in the following years. The public debate that took place in Germany at the time around these children's problem showed the extent to which post-war German authorities tried to distance themselves from the Nazi past and its racist policies, while at the same time they also attempted to keep this so-called Negro blood out of Germany by devising plans to send the children to the US to be adopted, or to other places, maybe African missions. But most of the children, must be said, eventually remained in Germany. And there is quite an interesting historiography on these Afro-Germans. In contrast to England, moreover, Germany's brown babies were the children of the war enemy, and thus not just of a war partner. And thus their presence was also a constant reminder of a crushing military defeat, and all, along with the issue of the mass rapes, contributed to configuring 1945 in terms of a sexual national or national sexual humiliation. Needless to say, the image of the women who had intimate relations with GIs was very negative, and consensual relations between German women and African American or African GIs were seen as symptoms of a national disorder that plagued the defeated country. I'm not aware of an analogous study done in France, but Tara Zera, in her study of displaced children, has shown how this country's immediate post-war policies regarding international adoption showed a clear preference for the adoption of the children of French men and German women born in the French sector of occupied Germany, but excluded those born from relations from German between German women and the North African troops, which were part of the French army. This exclusion was based on the old criterion, the criterion that French had been using also in determining which migrants they wanted, the criterion of assimilability, which actually masked racial and eugenic concerns. Now, brown babies were born also in Italy, as I mentioned, and one of the most famous cultural products of the war, the Neapolitan song Tamuriata Nera, refers exactly to the birth of one such child. The skin color of the child is described as very black. Okay, not just black, it's very near, so double. And I want you to listen a bit to, you've seen the lyrics there. The lyrics are heavily ironical towards those who claimed surprise at the occurrence and became immediately popular. So the song is based on a sort of traditional music, a Taranta kind of music, which is really quite a strong and rhythmically paced. And so it became very popular, and it appears in a number of films. Let's see if we can actually see, give you a sense of, did you find it? Okay. Thank you.
sotto la porta nessuna.
So you get an idea of how also the reason why it became so popular, because this, all this tamburelli and is just impossible to resist. But of course the theme may have helped too. And it appears, as a matter of fact, this was the interpretation given by, it was played by a group of folkloric group created in the 70s. And so it's also very well known to generations, right, of Italians. And it'd been you have seen only the original lines of the song, but then there were others added later, and it became, even more racially defined. I mean, who the people with references to the Marocchine, so also to the troops, not only just to the African Americans that you have seen here, by the way, that you probably recognize. That's one segment of Paisa, one of the episodes from Paisa. There are no black babies, but there is a black African, African American in the film, right? And so someone who has created this particular video must, has associated, of course, the two. I tried to actually play the another video, but there are sort of copyright issues in this country, so I couldn't play that one to show you the actual group that played the song. Anyway, so it was a feature, and actually I need to go, I probably can use this right here. Okay, oh, this is the score, where you can see also what, those who have studied the song, I'm not clearly the first one who has noticed the opposition between these very white and practically blonde here women, not so common in Naples, and also very white here, and the baby is very, very black. It was featured also in a film here that came out in 1950, called Il Mulatto. It was to which I want to return later. And this Il Mulatto had also several versions, right? It was called Angelo in a different ending in the American case, and then Mulatito in the Spanish version. And there is also a French version. Anyway, it circulated outside of Italy. And I mentioned that he was also featured again in a scene, and a famous scene in Bicycle Thieves. Anyway, in 1947, Paolo Monelli, a journalist and former supporter of the fascist Ethiopian war, as well of the racial policies of the regime, even published an exegesis of it on a major daily in La Stampa, reading the Neapolitan song as an expression of a rightful sentiment of popular revulsion towards race mixing. And it translates as, for those who do not know Italian, in that black creature, the Neapolitan people see the fruit of a union against nature, worse than an incest, almost a blind relation with an animal. You can call him Ciro, Pepe, Antonio, you can baptize him, but he will always remain something foreign to the race, to the fate, to reason itself. Anyway, quite strong words that we do not see, as a matter of fact, in the song itself, in which, of course, the song is othering the mixed race children, but not to this extreme degree, right? And the article was from which I took these lines was actually commenting on these little kids in the streets of Naples, right, that circulated in the streets of Naples. Now, the journalist also took the opportunity to question the motivations of the Americans who sent the black troops to fight in the Italian peninsula, claiming that they did it out of spite and contempt for the Italian people, because they considered the Italian, and I'm quoting, an inferior scholar. fascist list again appears from the words of Monelli, a war initiated by the fascists. The Republic. But hundreds of, let's say, of producers of ideology, which had been very integral, very organic to fascism, to the fascist regime, remained at their post in the school system, in the universities, and in the country's newspaper. But perhaps the most important factor that distinguished post-war Italy was the institutional role played by the Catholic Church, especially in the context of the early Cold War, in which the Church was a major player. Until his death in 1958, Pius XII was solidly on the side of Italian conservative forces, as obsessed about communism as he was when he engaged in the anti-communist crusade that he himself advocated and pushed around the elections of 1948. What were the views of the Pope and more generally of the Catholic Church with regard to race and racism? Well, while trying to call, to claim an anti-racist stance, as well as alleging an anti-racist past, the post-war church, in fact, shared the racial prejudices still widespread in Italian society towards people with a darker skin color, a legacy of both colonialism and, I would argue, also fascism. Both colonialism, meaning missionary colonialism, if we want to refer specifically to the role that the church had in the context. Indeed, important clerics and militant right-wing Catholics had a role in actively supporting or reproducing, more or less subtly, okay, with some changes, these prejudices. And I'm leaving aside the issue of the continuing, the persisting anti-Semitism also among the ranks of clergymen. As Lucia Ceci and others have argued, the Catholic Church had accommodated itself not only to fascist anti-Semitism, but also to the racist colonial laws introduced by the regime after the occupation of Ethiopia. It did not oppose the 1937 decree which criminalized unions, sexual unions between Italian citizens and colonial subjects. In fact, it praised the morality of the decree because it would repress the immorality of madamato, which is the madamismo, madamato, the term that was used to refer to the practice through which colonized women provided the comfort of home to male settler. It even offered its support for the policing of these relationships between natives and colonialists. Missionaries would work to impede hybrid unions for the sake of the wise, hygienic, and social motivation of the state. Some churchmen had rejected the biological, to be sure, some churchmen had rejected the biological inflection of race already in the 30s, but to which they prefer the term stock. Now, the term stock does refer to descent, so it is just a milder way of referring to the same thing, right? Blood, descent, and so on. But again, so they sort of not recognize that issue. Ideas and attitudes on race were slow to change after the fall of fascism, if they changed at all in the general population. And it did not help the fact that the Italian anthropological community did not even bother to translate or to discuss the critical statement on race issued by UNESCO in 1950 and 1951. Nobody bothered to remove the racist demographer Corrado Gini, for example, and his students from their posts in Italian universities. After the war, moreover, the church was busy rewriting its own history by associating racism primarily with Nazism and then only secondarily with Italian fascism and then defining it in a very limited way. And since Pius XI had criticized the extreme forms that ideologies of race and nation had taken, and since a number of Catholic clergymen and nuns had helped individual Jews to escape persecution, the church felt exonerated from any possible responsibility, and a blanket of silence fell on its lack of any explicit condemnation of anti-Semitism and its active collaboration in the racist colonial policy. In fact, the entry on racism in an authoritative work in many volumes called Encyclopedia Cattolica, which came out between 48 and 53, stressed the existence of a clear antithesis between the doctrine, what was called the doctrine and political practice of racism, and the tenets of Catholic morals, which teaches the equality in Christ of all men. Words that I'm taking from that. For the Catholic Church, self-absolution came easy. And given its role in Italian society, this self-serving narrative supported also the self-absolution of the Italian people. In fact, this is something I did not realize when I wrote my book, the extent to which this actually really, the narrative of the church reinforced this narrative of the brava gente, essentially, right? That came out from the war strongly, even though some basis existed before. So the construction of the bravo italiano owes a lot to the narrative produced by the church, also to absolve itself, of course. Yet exactly, so we're talking about the early 50s, exactly in the year when that particular volume of the Encyclopedia Cattolica came out, the various newspapers reported stories on the little mulattoes, the brown babies, I want to call them, born during and after, right after the war. These articles stressed the hostility which the children met in society, particularly as they began to attend elementary school and were exposed to the unconscious cruelty of other children. The press also reported on the efforts of a Catholic, and this kind of news, this kind of coverage, massive coverage in in the Catholic press, but also in other mainstream, other periodicals, reported on the efforts of a Catholic priest from Milan, Don Carlo Gnocchi, to help them by providing assistance and education. And so I just want to show you a few of these pages. Don Gnocchi vuole dare una laurea. This is greatly exaggerated. He didn't want to give him a university degree, but you can see them here, spinning a bit on the news. This is the Centro Raccolta dei Bambini. And here they are. So the priest with these kids who are mixed also with others, they were supposed to be temporarily there, and I'll tell you why. So anyway, until that here, it must be said that the news about the presence of these kids and how they were poorly treated and so on, was reported also before, but only very sporadically. Don Gnocchi, however, was a very powerful clergyman in post-war Italy, and he's been defined as the most important entrepreneur of charity of that period, and he had important friends in the press. In the fascist regime, he had served first as a chaplain of the Opera Nazionale Balilla, and then as military chaplain, he volunteered also during the war in the Balkans. And here is just part of this sort of little empire of homes that he created by creating this thing. and here when it was in the Balkans. And then it also served in the Soviet Union, in the disastrous route of the Soviet Union. And he probably had a change of heart at that point. He was no longer, after seeing the disaster, you know, the disasters of the war, he probably changed of heart, and he probably wanted to do something for his own soul. Anyway, this is also the way, I mean, it doesn't word it in that fashion, but there must be something of that kind. Anyway, in the post-war period, he had established, again, a reputation as a major, again, a major figure in the assistance of severely wounded and mutilated children, right, by creating that foundation that I'll, foundation called Pro Juventute. So the Catholic Church was heavily involved, I mentioned, in this business of assistance and intended to maintain its strong grip on it, especially at a time when it was worried about the attempts on the part of the Communist Party to influence the youth. So this was quite a crucial ground, let's say, in which the Cold War was fought. The Christian Democrats in power very much appreciated the role of the Church. Even though some were critical of the, let's say the more reformist one, were critical of the inefficiency of welfare provision provided in that fashion, piecemeal and not coordinated and so on. And they wanted to do reforms, but nothing was done at the time, or at least, I mean, there is not yet a full history of this area, right, for that period. There are sort of, again, piecemeal historiography on that. But anyway, the Donyoki's opinion on matters of assistance to war children was sought by a powerful or an emerging politician of Christian democracy, would be throughout, present throughout the history of Italy, of course, Giulio Andreotti, who was the undersecretary to the office of the prime minister in the early 50s. At the beginning of the 50s, Donyoki became also involved with the brown babies as a representative for the Italian government on the board of a quasi-state agency, which provided assistance to war victims. And it had been established much earlier during World War I. Soon he developed, soon Donyoki is a character, power, let's say, a very active character, developed his own ideas and plans about what should be done on what he called the problem of the little mulattoes. And since he did not trust state bureaucracies, he began pursuing his plan, a plan of his own. In 52, he was writing to a prospective benefactor, an Italian who lived in Brazil, or an Italian, someone of Italian descent. And I'm quoting, in Italy, another severe problem of the post-war has emerged, the problem of the children of the black soldiers who fought with the Allies, the problem of the little mulattoes. Until now, these little ones were almost kept hidden by their families, but now they are 7, 8 years old, and they must go to school and learn a trade. At schools, the other children throw stones at them. They do not often have the opportunity to learn a job, and generally they do not have much of an inclination to work. The girls, and this is of course a little touch of the misogyny of the clergyman, the girls, very precocious, are even more dangerous. If this goes on, they'll end up all living a nomadic existence and join the criminal class. And of course, this was a worry about, let's say, generally war children who could be an extremely, let's say, problem growing up, right? But there was something special about those with dark skin. Clearly, Donyoki had precise ideas about the psychological characteristics of what he called the black or colored race. Elsewhere, he mentioned how their character was very, I'm quoting, very different than that of our children. They are restless, they are asocial, primitive, prone to fight, even though they were also affectionate, right, and generous. And he says, and they are also intelligent and very vital, but there are other things that are problematic. And more interestingly, what this interests me was that he says, he mentioned the experts on the problem of the mixed race. And I'll return to this expert, who these experts were, who told him that the black race, I'm quoting, the black race becomes more dominant in the adolescent years, all right? So at first it's not so dominant. And this had led him to conclude that it would be better to prepare other ways for these children, noting also in another passage, in Italy they would always be excluded and strangers. Okay, so there are sort of, you know, a variety of motivations here at work. But Donnacchi thought that the problem should be solved, first of all, by gathering these children in separate houses, homes, as he already had done with other war victims. But in contrast to the others, war victims that he wanted to rehabilitate, once they'd been given a basic education and possibly a knowledge of the Portuguese language, they should be shipped to a country that would accept them. And interestingly, he came up with the idea that they should be sent to Brazil. Brazil, because it was a country where mixed, where race mixing was common, so they would not stand out. And they could possibly find work in the coffee plantations. The Italian who lived in Brazil, like the benefactor with whom he corresponded, could help in this respect. So he was trying to get, you know, to make a convincing case too. But certainly he had a definite idea that they, these children, although their numbers were not so big, but they did not belong in Italy. To this end, so he established also contacts with a Catholic congregation, which had missions in South America, and that was also in the business of providing assistance to abandoned children. The Catholic press always reported his view almost verbatim, right? Even though sometime in the newspapers, the headlines were put in quotation marks, perhaps indicating a feeling of uneasiness, especially from the mid-50s on. There was, let's say, unanimity on the benefits, or quasi-unanimity on the benefits of this transfer. And the Vatican agreed, so it gave its support. Let's say the voices, the critical voices of this plan came almost only from the leftist press that said, what is the problem? These are Italian citizens. Are we afraid of these? Are they afraid? Of course, there was also the Cold War climate with a lot of, you know, struggling to show that who was worse at the time. So they took And the press, the leftist press, were particularly unhappy when, or maybe happy to exploit this case, when he discovered that these children had been taken by Donnacchi in his homes, at least a number of them, away from a couple of former Jesuit priests who had fallen in a kind of, they were no longer popular with the Vatican, all right, to put it mildly. So they had been they'd really falling in disgrace, right? They don't, no longer. So anyway, he was very part of this plot, let's say, to take them away from these two priests. I want to go back to the language used in the representation of the brown babies. We mentioned problem, right? Problem, the problem of the children of the Negro soldiers, the problem of the mulatto children. One, in a newspaper, I see one reference to one of the most painful problems of the post-war period. These were some of the headlines, right? But what kind of problem? It's difficult to understand exactly what kind of problem these were. I do not know exactly how many there were, but they were certainly, by the mid-50s, there were not so many, because many also died. Those who had been, you know, left in those homes for abandoned children, foundling homes, they lived in terrible conditions. So quite a few of those died. So it was not all that clear what kind of problem, because they never explained it explicitly, right? They referred to these kids not being wanted. But the problem sounded a bit, you know, allusive to something else. So again, nobody said the problem is racism, all right? The problem is maybe their intrinsic difference. And this is what also what some of these articles, which reproduce almost verbatim the words of, that I found of in the correspondence of Donnacchi, said, right? There was something essentially different about them. Psychological, there were psychological differences, psychological traits that were not just the result of the environment, but just the way they were. So it was linked to, they were linked to their essence and temperament. So I would say the Milanese priest and others who operated in that area shared certainly some stereotypes that on mixed race and black people, which had been circulating for some time, not only those produced during the early liberal phase of colonialism, but more particularly during fascism. And of course, one can always go back to one of the periodicals, the fascist periodicals that propagated state racism in those years to see what right, the kind of problems associated with that. So the racist propaganda has always presented mixed race people as a problem from a biological standpoint, but also from a political standpoint, right? Dangerous to the maintenance of the superiority and prestige of the race in the colonies. And also, I would say more unstable, the character was more unstable and linked to, if you read Difesa della Razza, a whole issue on mixed race, and they are linked to revolutions, to political instability. Countries with mixed race, a large number of mixed race, are sort of more political and stable, and they showed, you know, Mexico and other. Now, in and one has also mentioned that in 1940, the regime prohibited Italians from recognizing the children they had with African women. And from helping, the other case was very, there were very few, of course, of Italian women having children with African men. And from also, so they prohibited Italians from recognizing and from helping to support them. This law, by the way, is still in the books until 1947. This explicit, although, let me just add, in 1944, the racial laws were abrogated. So there was, again, the conflict between different laws. This explicit racism does not show up in the papers of Don Gnocchi, who in fact publicly distanced himself by making a point of renaming the children of the sun. Okay, because they were, because little mulattoes sounded too zoological. So we say, we should not use the term. And yet the fact that he and others saw these children as lacking a nationality, although if they were born and were not recognized by their fathers, they were regular Italian citizens. And that he grouped them in one category, really based on racial criteria. So all this is very indicative of the persistence, again, of these racial categories, but also, of course, of the difficulties to conceive of the non-white as fully Italian. Don Gnocchi always referred, as I mentioned, to Latin America as a possible destination for the children, not to the US, but many in Italy, others actually had thought also of the African solution. There were, not to mention also the African Americans who, like in the case of other countries, would have liked to adopt these children, right, and organized in that way. The fantasy about the disappearance of the brown babies through their return to the other side of the Atlantic was present also in the 1950 film I mentioned before, which is, let's go to the cover again, in which you can see here, this is the, all of a sudden, Deus Ex Machina. This is that's the protagonist, Matteo, and this is the uncle of the child who all of a sudden shows up at the end and very efficiently takes the child back after the child has instinctually recognized him as his real kin, right? So this is the story, the film storyline promoted, on the one hand, the acceptance of the child based on a discourse of Christian universalism, as a very good analyst of this film has shown. But on the other hand, it racialized also the child, and in its ending indulged in this fantasy of its, let's say, actual expulsion, gentle expulsion of the foreign body from the nation, based on a segregationist vision that was also borrowed from certainly from local roots and American roots at the time too. It was also produced. The connection between this film and the Catholic world is that it was produced under the auspices of the Unione Cinematografica Internazionale fra I Cattolici, which was a new founded organization which was supposed to watch over the morality of film production at the time. A film made in Germany a couple of years later, Toxi, also indulged in a similar fantasy of disappearance, although it was, a much more successful film. Probably the director of the film had seen the Italian film, although there are we do not have evidence, but the similarity are quite remarkable. And it was the most successful film at the box office, but it was also, I would say, more sympathetic to the case of the child than the Italian one. First of all, it gave the child a name, right, as opposed to just calling it Il Mulatto, right? And this was a child, a fully articulate child, who spoke in beautiful German, right, and could generate a lot of empathy and sympathy in the audience, while the little Italian child is smaller, is only 3 years old, and does not. I mean, speaks very little, even though when he speaks Neapolitan, beautiful Neapolitan. Anyway, and he's also very cute and so on, because it has this, you've seen in the other painting, he has blonde hair. Anyway, let me just try to wrap up quickly. Don Gnocchi did not represent the old Catholic Church, and not all clergymen agreed with his project of sending the children in Brazil, but he was not an outlier either. He had powerful friends in the party, as we have seen, and he was probably close to another major figure of those years, very close to Pius XII. You can see him next to Pius, right? This is Luigi Gedda. For those who know the history of Italy in those years, Gedda was the person to whom Pius XII gave the task of organizing the anti-communist propaganda in 1948, in the elections, in the pivotal election of 1948. And he was probably the expert of the Métis problem that Don Gnocchi referred to. In 1960, Gedda and a couple of other physicians published a volume entitled Il Meticciato di Guerra, War Métissage, in which about 40 non-white children, war children, several of whom had been in the care of Don Gnocchi, were measured and tested in all sorts of ways, right? Very invasive ways, so from the color and shape of their hair and eyes to the shape and size of their noses. Not an inch of their bodies was left alone. Interesting enough, there is this kind of like war, a reference to, I don't know, antiquity, I guess. So pictures of these kids, repeatedly referred in the study as materiale meticcio, with this kind of ugly, scientific sounding term, okay? They were included at the end of the volume too. It's a bit blurred, it didn't come out all that well, but you can see the picture, the shots, they resemble police shots, and some of the children look as this one, particularly startled. So the authors were proposing, even though others had contested this idea, they proposed educational segregation for this kind of children, a bit late in the thing, but they thought that that was the best way of educating them. Gedda, too, I could talk about, his past, but you can imagine his past. He was another of those quite active voices during the racial campaign. But I will leave that on a side. I must say, the Brazilian, we do not know what exactly happened to this Brazilian plan. Probably it was never put into practice. I do not know for sure. I think it was not because Don Gnocchi died in 1956, and so since he was the main, the person who pushed more than others to this. But the idea points to what I called before missionary colonialism, Another breeding ground of Catholic stereotypes of non-white people. In the early 50s, missionary periodicals, such as those of the large order of the Missionari della Consolata, which was particularly strong in Turin, still talks about conquering the pagans of Africa to the true faith, displayed an incredibly paternalistic tone towards Africa, who were represented as primitive, but with a big heart, which is pretty much the same thing that they say about these children, big children who needed to be educated. The Catholic clergy in general expressed views that, if not explicitly racist, were strongly Eurocentric. And these views of the African character were then applied to the mixed race children born in Italy. The ecclesiastical world also continued to support colonialism in those years. And you just have to read the periodical of the Jesuit Civiltà Cattolica to see some of the voices in favor of the keeping on the part of Italy of the former colony, at least as trust, right? Which actually Italy was able to argue successfully at the peace negotiations and was able to gain Somalia for 10 years and establish a fiduciary administration in Somalia. So, and the way some of these people pleaded for these, for keeping these colonies sounded totally similar to what first the fascists mentioned about the high fertility of the of the Italian population. And then they mentioned also the same type of discourse that the pro-colonial lobby in the post-war period mentioned, that is, these colonies are really the results of, the labor of Italians, right? So linking colonialism and emigration, right, as it had been done before. So. So it's interesting to see how that continued again in this post-war period. And they were mentioning too, again, other tropes of Italian nationalist discourse, the superior civilization, the thousand-year-old culture infused with, and here the bravo Italiano comes in, universalist ideas full of deep humanness. which would make Italians organically unable, I'm quoting, to look with contempt at the populations of different civilizations, color or race. Now, let's say, I'm quoting here the words of a Jesuit father who also during the campaign for the conquest of Ethiopia had been full of praise for Marshal Graziani, and for what he called the marvelous speed of his military successes, to which the nation owed its gratitude. The Marshal, of course, as you know, had just massacred thousands of Ethiopians, guilty of having resisted the military occupation at that time. Now, the study of what happened to the brown babies in post-war Italy shows the extent to which the childhood experiences of a fair number of them were shaped by the presence of the Catholic Church and its vast network of homes for abandoned and orphaned children. The only published memoir which I know of is by a mixed-race Italian born right after the war and points exactly to this, to the strong presence of the Church. This is previous. But here we go, Nero di Puglia, right? The author, Antonio Campobasso, narrates his vicissitudes after his grandmother took him at age 9 to an orphanage run by nuns because she could not provide for him any longer. And she was also worried about him being, attacked by other children. So she thought that this would be some kind of refuge. For him, and he recalls clearly his experience was not so was not all that positive, and he recalls how a nun told him once that the color of his skin was the mirror of the dirt of his soul, and how in another occasion he was pushed to the end of a procession so that his color would not offend the little blonde ones who opened the procession. One is, of course, reminded here of the association between whiteness and purity that Christianity has strongly enforced for centuries. To conclude, in recent years, studies on the history of race and racism have emphasized the transnational construction of the idiom of race in the West. This was certainly true also in the case of post-war Italy. Jeddah, for example, the doctor who made himself into a geneticist, closely collaborated with die-hard geneticists in England and the US, who continued to press for the scientificity idea of the scientific nature of the idea of race, right? Devoid of any racism. And then we see the type of studies that they do. In other countries, too, mixed race people were subjected to measurements of all kinds. This doesn't seem to be an Italian peculiarity. I was just reading recently about, for example, France. I mean, it happened, first of all, with the anthropological study of Mischlinger's Kinder in Germany in the 50s, and it was still happening in France in the 60s, when an anthropometric study of the mixed race children brought from the former colony in East Asia to France was published in 1967. Moreover, studies on the experiences of these children have shown in the case of France, a greater involvement of the Catholic Church with them, right? More than with white children. That's revealing also the limits of the separation between church and state in a society, even in a society like France, where the separation is certainly more, and still is certainly more advanced than in Italy. Thus, to be sure, the role of the church in the all-important field of public assistance was not unique to Italy. However, in the case of Italy, the church was uniquely powerful and its reach wider. This feature may have also something to do with the fact that the subject of the brown babies has been neglected for such a long time in Italian historiography. In contrast to the historiography of other countries, where the topic was picked up already several years ago and had led to important and illuminating studies. And it's really reading this other historiography that, you know, made me think, why is it that, you know, Italians are so behind with this? I mean, what is the reason? I mean, there may be many reasons, right? There certainly are many reasons at the origins of this slowness, of this neglect, and we may want to discuss them later. But what is certain is that ecclesiastical archives in Italy are often very little accessible, okay? And even less than state archives, which has already a terrible reputation. But I tell you, ecclesiastical archives are worse. Although in this case, they were better, actually. They opened up, and I found out that they opened up while I was trying to identify some sources, because it was so difficult to find them in the state archive. But then I had a lead, so. And eventually they very nicely decided to open up their archives, which is really quite a trove of material. What is certain is that ecclesiastical, again, archives are also poorly inventoried, and I just have to tell you this because it's very interesting about how we forget about our past, what we did in our past, and we do not see, you know, the other group of children that Dognocchi assisted, the foundation of Gnocchi Assistis, are called mutilatini, okay? So there was actually, in the inventory, if there were references to mulattini, everybody would just read them as mutilatini, and the explanation that they gave me is because we didn't use racial categories. And then you go and see all this stack of documents, and the folders are the original folders, and the name mulattini is right there. So. How come we cannot see? Okay, we cannot. That's just an instance of we cannot see race, right, in our own approach to society. So it's a blindness, the blindness of the colorblind. So many reasons. So we mentioned these things. I would say that this kind of inability to reconstruct this recent past has very negative implications for a society that face today its change, its transformation, and believes that it's all the fault of the fascists. It's after fascism, things were different. We were no longer discriminating. So it's very important that we actually reconstruct what happens right then and see the multiples, let's say the multiples roots and origins of these attitudes. So the Catholic Church, let me just end by saying, right, it's important because the Catholic Church continues, or better, has an even more important role today, right? And it's been in Italy after the fall of the war, and I'm sure you are very aware of how Catholicism is used as a fundamental by the Northern League, by the anti-immigration parties, as a fundamental, you know, part of the identity of Italians. But the Catholic Church was not, it's not just an Italian actor, it's a global actor, and as we have seen, Italian clergymen at the time had connections with the Italian diaspora and with Catholic missions in South America, elsewhere in Africa. And these connections, I think, still need further investigation, and I would, of course, love to go and see what happened there, I mean, in Brazil, which would also be a good reasons for visiting a country which I never visited before. For that, I have to find funding for that. So the global role of this global player, among others, is one reason why we historians should pay more attention to the institutional and cultural role of organized religion in European societies, to which, after all, Max Weber called attention more than 100 years ago. So thank you for your attention.